Well, it's been a stormy week this week, hasn't it? With all these storms going around, it reminded me of a story that I heard about one summer night. There was thunderstorms going through this town, and severe thunderstorms, and there was a mother that was tucking her small son into bed. And the lightning was flashing through the windows, and thunder was crashing, and it was loud, and the little boy was scared. So he asked his mom to stay in his room that night. With a kind of a trembling voice, you've heard that. Mommy, would you just stay with me tonight? Just needing that comfort. And smiling, of course, his mother gave him a warm hug and reassured him that he was okay and so forth. And she just tenderly said, well, honey, I can't. I have to sleep in Daddy's room. Well, there was a long period of silence that followed that, and at last the silence was broken by that little shaky voice saying, the big sissy. Tomorrow's Father's Day. I had to get something in there about fathers. We can be big sissies at times, right? I didn't hear any amen, but I heard the giggles. This morning, we're going to be talking about the fight of our lives, fear. Basically, specifically, we're going to be looking at Elijah in 1 Kings and the story from his life there. But basically, what we're going to be talking about is fighting fear to take possession of God's provision, his promises. Newsflash. Probably not a newsflash. In this life, we're never going to win the war against fear. I'm sorry to bust your bubble with that, but you know it's true. There's fear in our lives. And we know that the fear never waves a white flag and gives up. Never lays down its weapons. It just never gives up entirely. You might not like hearing this, but we cannot win the war with fear. But we do want to hear this part. But we can win the daily battles with fear. Let me explain. Fear is a lot like the weeds in your yard. They have deep roots, and we pull them up, but we don't get all of the roots out. And what happens? They just grow back. And fear is kind of that way. The reason fear keeps growing back is that fear has a close relationship with our sin. You know what that is. I don't think it's a coincidence that the first time that fear appears in human history comes right after the appearance of sin. You remember the story with Adam and Eve. When they first sinned, what did they do? They ran from God and they hid. You remember God is walking through the garden and he calls out, "Where are you at?" Like he didn't know. And in Genesis 3:10, Adam responds, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid." Fear introduced. Why? Because I was naked. So I hid. And God goes on and says, what made you know that you were naked? And it was because they had disobeyed God and partaken of that fruit. They sinned. Sin was introduced. This is the first experience of fear. And it's rooted, like every fear since then, in the realization of our vulnerability. Our tendency are to recognize our weakness, to give in to temptation, to do some sin. Our fear is rooted in our vulnerability, and our vulnerability is rooted in sin. So why are we vulnerable? Because we've chosen to live independent, ultimately, from the source of strength, our source of strength, and that is God. Isn't that what sin is? It's the choice to say to God, I appreciate everything you've done, but I'm going to take it from you. That's sin. When we do that, we choose to cut ourselves off from the ultimate source of our strength. And we become vulnerable, which is the source of our fear. That is why I say that in this life, anyway, we cannot win the war against fear. But we can win most of the battle. We can keep the thistles from growing up in our lawn, in our lives. So we're going to be looking at 1 Kings this morning. And just to give you a little bit of background here, this is about Elijah. And we know that in chapter 17 that Elijah confronts King Ahab. God has a message for him. King Ahab is the king of the Jewish people. And he's been warned by God not to marry a Canaanite. But he falls in love with Jezebel. You've heard that name. And he marries her. And the reason he is not to marry her because she will pull him away from God, which happens. He marries her and he stops worshiping the true God and he starts worshiping her false God. And one of those false gods is Baal. And this is interesting. Baal is supposed to be the Lord of the dew and the rain. So God sends Elijah to Ahab and basically to tell him the true Lord of the dew and the rain says that the true God of the Lord of the dew and the rain says there's not going to be any more dew or rain until you remember the real source of dew and rain. At that point then, Elijah, he becomes public enemy, numero uno, of Ahab and especially Jezebel. But God takes him off and hides him, puts him into hiding. And there's another message that is right there. When you're hidden in God, you're hidden in God, not found by Satan. Good thing to pray for. But we know this went on from chapter 17 for 3 long, dry years. 3 years. No rain, not even dew. And then chapter 18, the word of the Lord comes to Elijah. He tells him to go and present yourself to Ahab. What's going on with Ahab? Remember, Ahab is wanting to kill him. And I will send rain on the land. So Elijah went to present himself to Ahab. Now, there's two things here I think that are important for us. First of all, God guides and provides, but only if we go. If God tells me, I'm going to provide for you over there, but I stay here, I don't receive his provision. If Dawn tells me, supper's ready, I guess it's dinner down here, dinner's ready, I said, okay, that's great, but I stay sitting on the porch. I stay hungry because I didn't go to the meal that she prepared for me. Same thing with God. God guides and provides, but only if we go. So God tells me to go over there. He tells us to go over there. And if we don't go, we don't get the provision. Now, what is hard about this situation in 1 Kings is where God is telling Elijah to go was scary. Go and present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the land. Remember, Ahab and his wife Jezebel had been looking for Elijah for 3 years, and they're frustrated by it. And here God is telling Elijah to go to them. The second thing I think we catch from this scripture is that taking provision of God's possession of God's provision always requires winning a battle against fear. So here's our question for today. Where is God guiding you, but fear is preventing you from going? Where is God guiding you, but fear is preventing you from going? Maybe it's a job you need to apply for. Maybe there's a hard conversation that you need to have with a certain someone. Maybe it's a sin in your life that needs to be addressed, needs to be confessed. We want to take possession of God's promises, right? But taking possession of God's promises always requires winning a battle against fear. So let's continue here with our story. Now the famine was severe in Samaria, and Ahab had summoned Obadiah, his palace administrator, and then it goes into a introduction of Obadiah. Obadiah was a devout believer in the Lord. King James says Obadiah feared the Lord greatly. While Jezebel was killing off the Lord's prophets, Obadiah had taken a hundred prophets and hidden them in two caves, 50 in each, and had supplied them with food and water. This is an introduction then to Obadiah. That phrase, feared the Lord greatly, is a literal translation of the original Hebrew. I inserted this literal translation here from the King James, well, because we're talking about fear. So that needed to be in there, right? But also this story. Fear is a big subject. Yeah. God has told Elijah to do something that would require him to fight fear. And Obadiah knows what it's like to fight fear too. While his master's wife, Jezebel, was killing off the Lord's prophets, he was protecting as many as he could, putting them in some caves and providing them food and water. By doing that, he was risking his own position. He was risking his own very life. But he did it. Why? Because he feared the Lord. I'm sure that he feared Ahab and Jezebel, but he feared the Lord more. Now, that brings up another subject for us. What does it mean to fear? A lot of us choose to come to a lot of our choices that we have. That's what it comes down to. Fear. And here Obadiah feared the Lord more than he feared the king and the queen. And that was what drove his choice that he made. Now there are two different kinds of fear. First of all, there's the fear of what might happen if I do. And then there's the fear of what won't happen if I don't. Obadiah's fear of the king and queen was a fear of punishment, possibly death. His fear of the Lord was a FOMO fear. You know what FOMO is? FOMO is a word that has just been put in the dictionaries. I think I read like 2011, something on that. But it's a word that has come out of our social media responses through texting and so forth. What FOMO means is the fear of missing out. The fear of missing out on something exciting. Pastor Craig Smith tells a story of when him and his wife went skydiving for the first time. And as he was standing in the open door with nothing but air out there in the earth below, he was having second thoughts. He was having a battle with fear. He was standing there, his words, this is dumb. Which I would agree with, I think most of you would too. This is dumb. You don't need to do this, Craig. Just tell the guy you changed your mind. That was the voice, one of the voices of fear. But then there was another voice in his head that, yeah, but if you back out now, your wife will never let you live it down. If you back out now, you will never know the thrill of flying. If you back out now, you'll never know the thrill of flying. That is FOMO. Fear of missing out. The fear of the Lord is a fear of missing out on something exciting. It's a fear of missing out on what would have been ours if we had just trusted God. It's not just about avoiding punishment. It's about finding life. Proverbs even says this. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life. Then in Luke we read, his mercies extend to those who fear him from generation to generation. The fear of God isn't just a fear of punishment. It's a fear of missing out on his promises. And Obadiah was more afraid of that than he was of possible punishment that could come for disobeying the king and the queen. So let's continue with our story in 1 Kings. Ahab said to Obadiah, remember there's been a severe drought 3 years, go through the land to all the springs in the valley. Maybe we can find some grass to keep the horses and mules alive. Why? So we will not have to kill any of our animals. This is severe. So they divided the land they were to cover. Ahab going in one direction and Obadiah going the other. As Obadiah was walking along, Elijah met him. Obadiah recognized him and bowed down to the ground and said, is it really you, my Lord Elijah? Yes, he replied. Go tell your master, that is Ahab, King Ahab, Elijah is here. Now, they've been looking for him for 3 years. Now, Elijah is doing something scary here by saying that. And he has a choice. He could have chickened out when he said, when asked, is it really you, my Lord Elijah? Yep, it's me. How you been? And high five, low five, fist bump, chest bump, whatever prophets do for greeting. He could have made that choice, but he chooses not to. Chooses to trust God with every step and take. And he says, go tell your master, Elijah is here. But this is also asking Obadiah to do something scary. And Obadiah, as we'll see, he feels it. Verses 9 and 12a. What have I done wrong, said Obadiah, that you are handing me your servant over to Ahab to be put to death? As surely as the Lord your God lives, there is not a nation or a kingdom where my master has not sent someone to look for you. And whenever a nation or a kingdom claimed you were there, were not there, he made them swear that they could not find you. But now you tell me to go to my master and say, Elijah is here. I don't know where the Spirit of the Lord may carry you. We die, leave you. If I go and tell Ahab and he doesn't find you, he will kill me. What happened to Obadiah and fear the Lord? Obadiah is caught in a battle here, a battle between fear and faith, which is understandable, right? We would probably be that same way in the same situation. But we're also seeing something important, an important principle here in action. Fear crowds out our faith. We see it in a couple ways here. His suspicion that God won't keep his promise. He's afraid God will carry Elijah away before Obadiah can get back with the king. Basically, he's afraid he's going to get Ahab and bring him back, and God is going to go, psych, I was just kidding. Now think about that. Think about it. Why would Obadiah, who fears the Lord greatly, why would he think that that was even possible? Because he's seen God do that before? No. His fear is crowding out his faith. The second thing it is doing is distancing himself from God in the world. We see his fear crowding out his faith in something Obadiah says in verse 10, as surely as your God lives, your God? The Lord wasn't just Elijah's God. The Lord was Obadiah's God. Also, and we know that Obadiah, he had faith in God. That's why he protected and provided for these 100 prophets. Despite the danger. So why is it all of a sudden late, the Lord, your God? Because he's afraid. Afraid of what might happen. And his fear is doing what fear always does. It crowds out his faith. It exposes his vulnerability. There's only so much room in our minds, and if we feed our fear, it will crowd out our faith. I know this is kind of gross, but how would you like to take them out to eat? Sumo wrestling. Not a big goal with it. There's a circle, and they just try to push one of them out outside of this circle. Our problem, I think, is that too many of us take our fear to the buffet. Well, we're our faith, we put on a diet. And it doesn't work very well, as you can see. Unfortunately, we often feed our fears. We feed our fears without realizing it. So how do we do that? Number one, we dwell on it. We dwell on our fear. And what we dwell on takes residence in us. What we choose to focus on looms larger and larger in our minds the more that we dwell on it, until it begins to take control of our minds. That is why Paul in Philippians 4 writes, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about, dwell on such things." Brother, we focus on what could happen if we do, instead of what won't happen if we don't. We've already kind of talked about that. We obsess over what could happen if we don't do what we know God's calling us to do, instead of what we know we for sure won't if we don't. Boy. Okay. We obsess over the could happen if we do what we know God's calling us to do, instead of what we know for sure won't happen if we don't do what God calls us to do. The third thing is that we give fear the final vote in our decisions. I do this pretty often, pretty frequently. Look, you can't silence the voice of fear. Not completely, anyway. I've been trying to follow Jesus for a lot of years now, and I have yet to find the mute button on fear. But I'm trying to learn that just because it can't be silenced, just because it can't be silenced doesn't mean that I have to listen to it. That's the voice of fear. And it certainly doesn't mean that I have to give in to it. As loud as the voice of fear can be sometimes, we have a choice. We can choose to say to fear, "I hear your voice, but you don't get the final vote." And what we have to understand is that this is not a one and done time, one and done thing. It's something we have to do pretty regularly. Continue with our story of 1 Kings. Obadiah completes that sentence yet. I, your servant, have worshipped the Lord since my youth. Then he goes into this. Haven't you heard, my Lord, what I did while Jezebel was killing the prophets of the Lord? I hid 100 of the Lord's prophets in 2 caves, 50 in each, and supplied them with food and water. And now you tell me to go to the master and say, Elijah is here? You would kill me. Obadiah wants his past history of faith to exempt him from this present battle with fear. In other words, you've heard my track record, right? I didn't give in to fear back then. I chose faith. So, do I really have to do this all over again? Unfortunately, choosing faith over fear isn't a war to win. It's a battle you choose to fight every day. Every day we have to lace up our boots, we have to put on a helmet, we have to pick up our shield, and pull out our sword, and choose faith over fear. Verse 8 or 15. And Elijah said, as the Lord Almighty lives, whom I serve, I will surely present myself to Ahab. What Elijah is doing is giving Obadiah a promise that he'll be there. And that is helpful. Assurances. Assurances are great, aren't they? Problem is here is that no amount of assurance will change the nature of the battle. Because you are still going to have to fight the battle with fear. The issue has never been what God's promises to do. That's never the issue. The issue is always whether or not Obadiah here is going to trust those promises. And that is our battle. Are we going to trust God's promises? I read somewhere that there is between 400 and 500 promises that God makes in the scriptures. One thing we know is that God cannot lie, and every one of his promises are true. Every one of those I wills that we underline in the Bible, in the scriptures, are promises that we can hold on to. Assurances that we can hold on to and trust. So how does all this turn out? So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to Elijah. Obadiah did what you and I, as followers of Jesus, ultimately have to do. We have to choose faith over fear. Not one time, but every day. So how do we feed our faith and not our fear? We feed our faith by, like we talked about, dwell on the faithfulness and the goodness of God. By focusing on FOMO, not missing out on something exciting that God has for us. And to tell fear, I hear your voice, but you don't get the final say, the final word. So I'm going to leave you with the question for you to think about today. Where is your battle of fear taking you today? Where is the battle of fear, your battle of fear, taking you today? Father, this is something that every one of us struggle with. some more than others. And Father, we struggle with it because of our weakness, of our vulnerability that we know we have when it comes to sin. Father, we thank you for your spirit that you place in us to give us your strength, to give us your joy, to give us your peace, to give us your confidence. And Father, so many times we let our fears and what we're facing, the possibilities, push our faith to the background. Father, I know that all of us need reminding every day of what you've done for us and how much you love us, which you do. Help us, Father, to pay attention to that and to let you truly be Lord of our lives and how we live our lives and how we make decisions and how we handle our fears that we face. Father, help us to let you be our strength. I ask it in Jesus' name.